Ready?
Yep.
Yeah, okay. So it's my pleasure to introduce Konstantin Shramov from Estekhov and Higher School of Economics, who's going to speak about automorphisms of Severi Brouwer surfaces.
Thank you for the introduction. Thank you for the invitation. It's very nice to be in Edinburgh once again on this EDGE event, which I visit regularly and for the first time under such circumstances. So my talk will be out of the main topic of the conference. Maybe the only thing that it shares with the topic of the conference is the word explicit. But anyway, I will discuss automorphisms of Severi Brouwer surfaces. More precisely, it will be a finite group of automorphisms and finite group of birational self-maps of Severi Brouwer surfaces. So let me, just to start with, let me remind that, before I remind what's a Severi Brouwer surface, let me remind that the group of birational self-maps of P2 is a kind of popular object, and people used to study it for a century and a half. So it's called Cremona group. In particular, people ask what are the finite subgroups therein. So because the whole group is very huge and it's hard to understand as a whole, although there are spectacular results about this as well. So let's assume that we're interested in finite subgroups of inside this huge group. And after many years of attempts to understand this classification of such groups, it was obtained by Dolgachev and Iskoskich. In 2009, so they like more or less classified all such subgroups in a number of described them, divided them in a number of cases, and some cases were more explicit, some cases were less explicit. So overall, there are several long lists. And inside there are many complicated groups. Just to comment what I mean by complicated, let me give a couple of examples. For instance, there is a group A6 of even permutations of six items. This is maybe it's not so huge, but at least it's simple non-abelian group. There is a group PSL2 over the field of seven elements. This is also a simple finite non-abelian group, and all of them are actually contained in the automorphism group of P2. This is all over. All of this happens over an algebraically closed field of characteristic zero. If the field is not algebraically closed, then the list will be smaller. And also there is a group like A5 cross A5 semi-direct by an additional involution, which obviously acts on P1 cross P1, but doesn't act regularly on P2. But anyway, it embeds into the group of birational self-maps of P2. And life here is very tough. And what I want to discuss today is a kind of adjacent problem So I want to ask the same question about the nearest relative of the projective plane. My main character today will be a severe Brouwer surface. Over a field K, everything will be in characteristic zero for today. Some of part of the story generalizes to arbitrary characteristics, but let's not go into such details. By definition, it means that so S itself is defined over some algebraically non-closed field, and if I take the extension of scalars to the algebraic closure, then it will be isomorphic to the projective plane. And in particular, the projective plane itself is a severe Brouwer surface. I will let's assume that it's a trivial example of a severe Brouwer surface, and all the rest, all the remaining surfaces will be non-trivial. Now there is a beautiful theory of such surfaces, of, and in general of severe Brouwer varieties, which are forms of higher dimensional projective spaces. For instance, they are in one-to-one correspondence with central simple algebras over K. The dimension of the algebra depends on the dimension of the severe Brouwer variety. For surfaces, these need to have dimension 9. For instance, under such correspondence, the matrix algebra of 3 by 3 matrices corresponds to the trivial severe Brouwer surface. And also, you can formulate many, you can formulate pretty much in terms of such algebras. For instance, if S corresponds to an algebra A, then you can express the automorphism group of S in terms of A. It will be the group of invertible elements of A quotient by the scalars. For instance, if we are discussing P2 itself, then it will be the group of invertible matrices, which is GL, over scalar matrices. Overall, it makes PGL. And in for an arbitrary severe Brouwer surface, is going to be such a form, an inner form of the group PGL. There are other nice general facts about such objects. For instance, if whenever you have a point over the Bayes field, then your surface is isomorphic to P2 over the Bayes field without passing to the stationary scalars. So everything here is becomes non-trivial only over algebraic non-closed fields where you are allowed to have varieties without points. And everything here is pretty much analogous to the station of conics over algebraic non-closed fields. As everybody knows, there is only one conic, which up to isomorphism, which has a point, and there may be plenty of other conics which have no points. Okay, let me formulate an analog. Yes, I explained that there is nothing, the structure of the automorphism group of such a surface is pretty straightforward. But as usual, the structure of the group of birational self-maps is much more complicated. So what I want to do today is to explain an analog of Dolgachev-Iskovsky result in the case of such surfaces. And the main point here is that the result is much simpler, and the answer to the classificational question is much, much simpler. So I think that it will fit on the next screen. It will more or less fit on the next screen. So the result which I am going to explain is like this. So let S be a non-trivial Severe Brouwer surface and over some field of characteristic zero, everything will be over characteristic zero. And first let G be a finite subgroup in the usual automotion group of S. Then G is one of the following. First, it can be a cyclic group. It can be a cyclic group, but the order is not arbitrary. Here, my N is going to be the product of some prime numbers in some powers, but all of these prime numbers have to be congruent to 1 modulo 3. Or it may be a cyclic group of order 3 times larger. It may be a semi-direct product of such a cyclic group with Z over 3. And once again, not every semi-direct product is allowed. The condition for the semi-direct product to appear in such list is that, let me formulate it. So any semi-direct product is given by a homomorphism from the right-hand part to the automorphism group of the left-hand part. So we have the semi-direct product structure is given by a map from Z over 3 to the multiplicative group of Z over N, which in turn is isomorphic to, so I have, let's assume that N is written as a product over the prime numbers. So we have the product of multiplicative groups of cyclic groups of this order, and it will be isomorphic to Z over pi to the power I r I minus 1 times Z over pi minus 1. And so here, let me remind you once again that all pi's are congruent to 1 modulo 3. So the order of this guy is not divisible by 3, and the order of this guy is divisible by 3. So from here, I have many projections to Z over 3, pi I. And so I have many maps like this. That would be psi I. And I demand that psi I is isomorphic for all i's. Let me call this semi-direct products. Let me call it a balanced semi-direct product. There are many of them. And finally, I may have a group like this, Z over 3 times a semi-direct product like this, and nothing more. But for the moment, this is only about the usual automorphism group. So still we didn't reach the birational part, and let me remind you once again that the main difficulty in the case of the usual projective plane was in the barrational part. So there are many more finite groups acting on P2 birationally than finite groups acting on P2 by regular transformations. And here the situation is strikingly different. So let's suppose that G is a finite group inside the group of birational self-maps, but let's assume that G is not one of the group one of the groups appearing in the first part of the assertion. Then there are only few possible groups like this. Then G is isomorphic to Z over 3 to the power R, where R equals 0, 1, 2, 3. And finally, the third assertion is all such groups are realized for certain field K and surface S. Well, maybe let me make it more clear. Maybe I shouldn't say that all such groups are realized, but every such group is realized for some field and some surface, some non-trivial severe Brauer surface over this field. It's possible that for a given severe Brauer surface, not all this list is available on this particular severe Brauer surface, but for every group from this rather short list, you can find a field and a severe Brauer surface which with an action of such a group. Fine, let me make a couple of comments about this classification. So, well, first, it's much shorter than in the case of the projective plane, and I would say it may be not so exciting. It doesn't contain anything like non-abelian simple groups, but nevertheless, I find it nice. So, one particular comment is that so if G is a finite subgroup in the group of birational self-maps of such a non-trivial sphere Brauer surface, then we can see from that list that there exists a normal abelian subgroup inside G of index whose index equals either 1 or 3. So it's at most 3. Well, in other words, one can say that the Jordan constant of the group of birational self-maps is at most 3. Well, the Jordan constant is exactly the maximum of all such indices of abelian subgroups inside finite subgroups of a group. And it can be compared with the Jordan constant of the group of birational self-maps of P2 over algebraically closed field of characteristic zero. This equals 7,200. So once again, it tells us that any form of P2 has a much simpler group of birational self-maps than P2 itself. And this constant is achieved exactly on the group which I presented on the first screen, f5 cross a5, same direct as u over 2. Second comment that over some particular fields, it's possible that the structure of all birational self group of birational self maps is even simpler. So if, for instance, if we see it over the field Q, then every and S as usual is a non-trivial severe Brouwer surface over Q, over Q, and G is a finite subgroup in the group of birational self-maps, then there are very few opportunities for G. Then G is isomorphic to Z over 3 to R to some power, and the power maybe 1, 0, 1, 2, and 3. And nothing else is possible over the rational numbers. And maybe the final comment is that one can give a very neat description of quotients of such surfaces over over of quotients by finite automorphic groups. So this was communicated to me by Andrei Tripalin. So if once again S is a non-trivial sphere Brouwer surface, well, actually here it's not even necessary to assume non-triviality. So if G is a finite subgroup inside the automorphic group, then one may ask about the birational type of S quotient by G. And it appears that rather often this guy is birational to P2. And this happens if and only if it has at least one K point. And this in turn happens if and only if the order of the group is divisible by 3. And on the other hand, one may wonder what happens if the order of the group is not divisible by 3. This is the case when this guy has no K points, and in particular, it doesn't have a chance to be birational to P2, because having a point is a birational invariant. So now we so it's birational to something not to P2 but something else, and it appears that in this case it's birational to a severe Brouwer surface, and moreover exactly to the severe Brouwer surface we start from. Okay, now let me tell you how we obtain, how one can obtain such a classification. First, first, let me remind you let me tell you a little bit about birational models of severe Brouwer, of non-trivial severe Brouwer surfaces. And so there is one very nice theorem which generalizes the fact that if a severe Brouwer surface has a point, then it's birational to then it's isomorphic to P2. So the theorem is that if S has of degree not divisible by 3, then S is isomorphic to P2. And let me formulate a nearly trivial corollary from this, is that if S is a non-trivial Severe Brouwer surface, then S cannot be birational to a conic bundle. And S cannot be birational to a Delpezzo surface of degree not divisible by 3, different from 3, 6, and 9. And the proof is very straightforward. For instance, let's consider the conic bundle case. Suppose that S is birational to a surface with a structure of a conic bundle. And since everything is geometrically rational in this story, this is a conic bundle over a conic. And it may have no points, but at least the base, the conic, has a point of degree 2, of degree at most 2. And so you have a Galois orbit which consists of at most 2 fibers of this conic bundle, and this conic and every fiber is a conic over the residue field. And if it is a singular conic, then it obviously contains a point over the field of definition. If it's a smooth conic, then once again it contains a point of degree at most 2. So overall we are going to have a point of degree 2 or 4 on our surface, on our birational model, and by a standard theorem of Lang and Nishimura, we are going to have a point of degree 2 or 4 on S, and by the above theorem, it implies that the surface S is a trivial sphere Brouwer surface, which is not the case by assumption. And now this allows us to understand all the birational geometry which we need to study the group actions. There is a usual way to study finite groups acting birationally on a given surface or on a given variety of higher dimension, which basically comes from the G equivalent, from the equivalent minimal model program. And this approach tells you that first you can start with a group acting birationally on your surface S, then you can replace it by another birational model where GX, so here GX birationally, here GX biregularly. But then even if you started with a good surface with a birational action, now you already have a biregular action, but now you don't have any control on the properties of your new birational model. So you don't know anything about S-Tweedle except for the fact that it's birational to S. It's a smooth surface birational to S. But then there is an industrial method of improving the properties of a given smooth surface. It's called a G minimal model program, which just makes some G equivalent contractions and replaces your S-Tweedle by another smooth surface, also with a regular action of G, but with nice properties. And these nice properties, let me mention a couple of them, which I will need. So this S prime is either a conic bundle or Delpezzo surface with Picard rank equal to 1. So in our case, let's use this approach together with what we had on the previous screen. In our case, this means that S prime is a Delpeza surface. Of degree 3, 6, or 9. So my plan is like this. So first, let me ignore the case of degree 6 because it's the most boring one. This is boring. And the most boring part is that it doesn't give rise. Actually, it cannot serve as a G minimal model for any action of a finite group on a non-trivial severe Brouwer surface. So I won't comment on this case. I'll give a brief comment on the case of degree 9, and then a little bit less brief comment on the case of degree 3. Basically, the case of degree 9 is nearly clear because the Delpeza surface of degree 9 is a severe Brouwer surface itself. So it may be not exactly S itself, it may be a different severe Brouwer surface, but degree 9 is a form of a projective plane. Over algebraically closed field, it's just a projective plane, and over algebraically non-closed field, it may be some other surface which becomes isomorphic to a projective plane under the extension of scalars. And this case is taken care by some theorem. It actually says a little bit more than necessary to take care of degree 9 case. So let me formulate it in larger generality. It's a simple theorem. It was proved long ago, and then the author posted on the archive something like 45 years later than he proved it. So as usual, S is a non-trivial severe Brouwer surface. The assumptions are rather mild. It's maybe in any characteristic different from 2 and 3 or over a perfect field. And S prime is birational to S, and S prime is a Delpeza surface of Picard rank equal to 1. Then first, S prime is a severe Brouwer surface itself, and moreover, S prime is isomorphic either to S or to the opposite severe Brouwer surface, which means that so S corresponds to some central simple algebra, and you can produce another central simple algebra just by taking the multiplication in the opposite order. It may be non-isomorphic to the initial central simple algebra, and the severe Brouwer surface corresponding to it is called the opposite severe Brouwer surface. And maybe people who are experts in birational rigidity stuff, when they see the statement of the theorem, they already know how to prove it, and that's totally correct. It's easy to prove it, but the historical fact which I like about this theorem is that it was proved before the theory of birational rigidity took the present day form. In particular, in our case, a very particular case of this theorem tells us that we can, if we are in degree 9 case if our group has regularized on a severe browser, another severe browser surface, then it acts either on regular on S itself or on the opposite severe browser surface. Well, actually, to prove this particular statement, there was an easier way for us. Anyway, let me give a comment about degree 3. Then, in this case, S prime is a smooth cubic surface, and we know pretty much about automorphism groups of cubic surfaces. So basically, the automorphism group of S prime, there may be different automorphism groups. There are different automorphism groups of different cubic surfaces, but all of them are embedded into some universal group. It's the Weyl group of the root system E6. It's a huge group, and in characteristic zero, you have no cubic surfaces which even approach this group. They're all like much smaller in size. But anyway, there is some universal finite group which contains all possible groups here. And the main observation which we can make here is that in our case, when S prime is birational to some severe Brouwer surface, so it means that, in particular, it means that S prime has no points over the field of definition, then the automorphism group of S prime is a free group. So it has order 3 to some power r. And let me comment on the proof. So if it is not a free group, then it has some element of order of prime order p, which where p is different from 3. And on the other hand, we know a little bit about the structure of the Weyl group. Well, we know everything about the structure of the Weyl group, and in particular, all prime divisors are 2, 3, and 5. So we have to understand what is wrong about having an element of order 2 and order 5 on such a cubic surface. And then it appears that the fixed point locus of G on so if we go to the algebraic closure of S prime, then there is something wrong about the fixed point locus of such an element G. Namely, let me not go into all the details, but the idea is that you can classify all elements of order 2 and order 5 acting on cubic surfaces over algebraic closed field. There will be several types of them, but all of them will have something wrong about the fixed point locus. Typically, you will have a unique isolated point in this fixed point locus. For instance, for one of the elements of order 2, the fixed point locus is a smooth elliptic curve and one isolated point. So this isolated point is Galois invariant, so it has to be defined over the base field. So it has to give a point on S prime over K, which is not the case by assumption. And so we already know that the order of the automorphism group of such cubic surface is 3 to some power. And after some, after a little bit more work, you can actually conclude that if our cubic surface is birational to a non-trivial Sverre-Brauer surface, and G acts by is a finite group acting by automorphisms of such a cubic surface, such that G is not conjugate. A subgroup of the automorphism group of S, then G is just isomorphic. G is contained in the group Z over 3 to the power of 3. Well, let me mention that that the seal of three subgroup of the Weyl group we are interested in has order 3 to the power 4. So the gap between the previous result and this result is not very large. It's just working with some rather explicit three group. So the seal of three subgroup is not abelian, but looking once again at fixed points, you can figure out that the only possible thing is its abelian subgroup. And such groups as a group G in this corollary really exist. Such situation is possible so let me give you an example. Let's take some algebraically closed field, say the field of complex numbers. Let's take two transcendental variables and let K be such a field, algebraically closed field with two transcendental variables adjoined. And let's take a cubic given by equation given in P3 by equation like this, lambda s cube plus lambda squared y cube plus mu z cube plus mu squared t cube equals 0. And then there is an action of the group z over 3 to the third power, which just does the obvious thing. It's the field generator multiplies x by a cubic root of unity, the second generator does the same with y, and the third generator with z. And well, note that you do have a cubic root of unity here in the field. And also one can check that this cubic surface, so this guy acts on my cubic surface, and one can check that this cubic surface has no points, and moreover, is birational to some Sverre-Brauer surface. So it means that this group, which acts regularly on S prime, embeds into the birational self-maps of some non-trivial Sverre-Brauer surface over this field. So such, so here you see that if we, in the previous corollary, it tells us that if we had some group with a birational action on a Sverre-Brauer surface, then due to all this minimal model process and classification of possible birational models of sphere Brouwer surfaces, we know that all such groups can actually be regularized on S itself, except for a couple of exceptions. And this example tells us that exceptions really exist. So life is very simple, but not exactly trivial. Now, let me go further. So up to now, we see that if you want to understand a group of birational self-maps of sphere Brouwer surfaces, then it more or less, up to a couple of exceptions, it more or less boils down to understanding the group of usual automorphisms. And so now we have to understand something about the automorphism group of in the usual sense. And so let me make a simple observation. Here it will be, as usual, a finite group. That the order of G is odd. So indeed, suppose that you have an element of order 2. Then the fixed point locus of G on the extension of scalars of our surface. So let me remind you that the extension of scalars is P2. And we know pretty well all the involutions, all the regular involutions on P2. So the fixed point locus is always a line plus a point. And so the point is unique, and so it's preserved by and this automorphism is defined over the base field K. So its set of fixed point is preserved by the Galois group of K bar over K, and in particular this point is preserved by the Galois group, and so it's defined over K. And this means that there is a K point on our surface, which is not the case by assumption. And now one can obtain further restrictions on the group G, but let me just mention that the single fact that G, that the order is odd, implies many restrictions. For instance, G cannot be a simple non-abelian group due to some complicated theorem from group theory. Every finite simple non-abelian group has even order. But I don't really want to use this particular restriction about being not simple, but it just illustrates how strong is this trivial observation. So how many restrictions it gives you. And in particular, there is a remark which looks a little bit strange from the first sight, that finite groups acting on sphere Brouwer surfaces have simpler structure, like better structure than finite groups acting on Severi-Brauer curves. Although the dimension of the curve is just one, and in many other situations, groups acting on P2 have more complicated structure than those acting on P1, and here the life is organized in a different way. For example, let's take the Severi-Brauer curve, which means the conic given by equation x squared plus y squared plus z squared equals zero over R. And then like all finite subgroups, its odd Mortian group is SO3 of R, and all finite subgroups of SO3, for instance, the icosahedral group, which is a finite simple group at here. And such thing is impossible for surfaces, and actually impossible for any even dimension, because in even dimension, because if we mimic this observation in the case of curves, then we'll get enough, some other restriction, not that the order of group is odd, and somehow it appears that for the finite group, the order being odd is a very strong restriction, and the order being not divisible, say by 3, is a weak restriction. So life is not very fair in this place. Okay, maybe let me. Skip the details here. So basically, the plan of obtaining the whole classification is to. So we already reduced everything to the question about the usual odd Mortian group instead of variational odd Mortian group, and then we can work a little bit to obtain restrictions like this. This is, of course, not the only restriction which we can obtain on the group action on a non-trivial Severi-Brauer surface, but then all of them will be enough to tell you that if you have a finite group, then it's one of the least. So let me, maybe as a final step, let me show an example how one can prove that some groups, all the groups from that list, are realizable, so that they act on some Severi-Brauer surfaces. So, for example, let me take a prime number, which is congruent to one, which is not forbidden by our necessary conditions, modulo 3, and let's consider the group isomorphic to z over p, semi-direct product with z over 3, and that'd be non-trivial semi-direct product. And in my terminology, non-trivial meant in this particular case, when the number here is prime, it was the same as to require that it's balanced. I want to construct some field and some Severi-Brauer surface with an action of such group. Let me start with a field. So first, let me take a primitive non-trivial root of unity of degree p, and let L be the rationals with this thing adjoint, and it's a Galois extension of Q, so the Galois group of L over Q is isomorphic to Z over P minus 1. And in particular, so P minus 1 is divisible by 3. So over here, I have an embedding, I have a homomorphism from Z over 3. Actually, it's the same homomorphism as the one which gives the semi-direct product structure. And when I have a group of order three inside the Galois group, I can take its field of invariance. And now the L over K is a Galois extension, and its Galois group is exactly Z over three. So it's a cyclic Galois extension. And now there's a norm map, the Galois norm map, which acts from L to K, and as usual with number fields, you have plenty of elements in K which are not in the image of this Galois norm. And to every data like this, a cyclic Galois extension and an element not from the image of the Galois norm, one can associate the so-called cyclic algebra, which is basically the most straightforward definition of what we do when we construct a quaternion algebra. So it's generated by the field L and an additional element alpha with relations first that alpha cube equals A, and also let us choose in this Galois group, let's choose a generator sigma of the Galois group, and then we have to explain how alpha interacts with L. So if lambda is some element from L, then lambda alpha equals alpha sigma of lambda. And now let's apply this. So in particular, somewhere inside L, we have an element zeta, which is the root of unity. In particular, zeta alpha equals alpha sigma of zeta. And so, sigma of zeta. And this is just some power of zeta. So it raises zeta to some power d such that d cube equals one modulo p. And now the final step, we just let us take the images of alpha bar and zeta bar, the images of alpha and zeta in A star, they live in A star quotient by K star. And what do we know about these elements? So first, alpha was not an element of K, and alpha cube, it was equal to A, it was an element of K. So it means that the order of alpha bar equals three. On the other hand, similarly, zeta was not an element of K, and zeta to the power p was an element of K. So in the quotient, the order of zeta bar equals p. And also we have a commutation relation. So zeta bar alpha bar equals alpha bar zeta bar to some power d. And these three properties just tell you that alpha bar and zeta bar generate. These are just defining relations of the semi-direct product, generate the group G isomorphic to Z over P, semi-direct with Z over three. And along the same lines, with slightly more, a little bit more complicated constructions, but also boiling down to cyclic algebras, you can actually realize all the elements, all the groups which I promised to realize. I think I will stop here. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Kostya. Thank you very much. I'm going to pause the recording and it's time for questions.